Sorry, Brother David, it didn't get you, but anyway, we're live now. It says we are live. Yeah, I don't even think Memorex is this good, so. All right, sorry about the interruptions this morning. Anyway, we try to get this into home, so we're coming in a little later. We didn't have any sound for some reason. It showed sound on the computer, but you know, well, anyway, there's where we're at. So we are getting part of the service out, and we're glad that they can listen with us today. Sorry to you that we had to interrupt things a couple times there. Well, let me just share with you several specific prayer needs today that we need to remember and encourage you to pray for today. If you would remember Darian Sparling, this is a Greg and Jesse Gullett's daughter. She is in OSU hospital in the ICU, very bad case of pneumonia. They've had to put her on a ventilator yesterday, and so she is sedated at this time, 21 years old, and she has cystic fibrosis, so, which is just a devastating disease. So please pray for Darian, if you would, today in a special way. Also, if you would, remember the family of Louise Walters. We had asked prayers last week. She wasn't well, and she went home to be with the Lord just a couple of days ago. So we ask you to be in prayer for the Louise Walters. Her husband's name is Max, and Jill Lippert, that has attended here anyway, that's a niece. And so just pray that the family would be blessed. We may be having a funeral, possibly, this week in regards to that, so just to let you know that. Then also, if you would remember Sue Berry, it's good to see her here with her smiling face and just a little bruise. She fell over at the fellowship hall anyway. I think our food was a little too heavy. I don't know if that's what it was or not. But anyway, but she's okay, just a little bruise as a result of the fall. But anyway, pray for her and that to heal. And then if you would continue to remember my sister Ruth in prayer. She's in the nursing home in Marion Point, and just pray that God would continue to bless her in a special way. Also, Nancy Jenkins, I know, is in need of prayer. Linda Shiflett is, I think, finished treatment. Is that right? So and so we're thankful to hear the chemo is over with, so be in prayer. Good to see Cheryl Pennington here today, and please pray for the remainder ones on the prayer list: John Cockerell, Bob Johnston, Michael Varner, Cheryl Chevalier, Bill Scott, Hazel, and Carl Blankenship, Beth Miller, Sean Dunn, Madison Marvich, also Don Griffin, Harvey Irvine, David Grace, Becky Varner, Marcia Edwards, Robin Marvich, Herman Daniels, Harold Shea, Diane Denny, Julie Hoffman. It is Julie in July, correct? Okay, still that, okay. And then Jonathan Wallace and Ruth Ella Holt. So please pray for all of these. We thank you for your efforts to pray diligently for these folks. Any other special prayer needs? Brenda?
Yes, my friend Kathy Weir.
Okay, yes. Okay, remember Kathy Laird in your prayers, please. Yes, Sharon?
My name is Jeff Carwell. His toe is black. They are trying to say that there's a 50-50 chance that it can be saved.
Okay, Jeff Cardwell? Okay, remember Jeff Cardwell, toe in not in good shape. Yes, Cheryl? Yes, Tim. Yeah, well, remember your family in prayer. So he has a sister in the hospital as well as one at home not doing well. And Cheryl?
My friend Sandy Akers, that used to come here occasionally with me, he's having a hard time
Okay. So remember Sandy Akers in your prayers, more testing. And then Kay Crabtree had a heart catheterization done this week, and she is sitting here smiling at me. Well, sort of smiling. Okay. Anyway, pray for Kay. Anyway, things came out pretty good on the test, but they are going to maybe do a procedure here in the near future. So pray for her. Anyone else? All right. Okay, a number of prayer needs, and certainly we're thankful that we are a believing church in prayer and the power of prayer, and glad that we have this opportunity today. We're going to sing How Great Thou Art, just the chorus, and we'll sing that through twice. Second time, if you have an unspoken request, and please, you who are listening on our program on Facebook at home, if you have an unneed or need, raise your hand and we'll pray for that as well. As we go, as we sing, then sings my soul.
Then sings my soul, my Savior God, to thee. How great thou art, how great thou art. Then sings my soul, my Savior.
Father, we do thank you for this opportunity to come before you. Lord, it's a privilege to be here this Sunday morning with your people. And Lord, we love each one here, each one listening. We're thankful, Lord, that you have provided us an opportunity to share the gospel of Jesus Christ. So today, Lord, bless those, we pray, who are here. And Lord, we look forward to honor you and blessing you in this hour that we have. Lord, we pray for these many prayer needs that have been mentioned. And Lord, we would ask today that your will would be done in lives. Just touch each one that needs a special moment of grace in their hearts, perhaps a healing hand. And Lord, we pray that your hand would touch many, many today. Lord, we pray today for the service and that you'll lead us and guide us, and that what we do here would be pleasing in thy sight. And Lord, we pray for this opportunity that is given us. Might we not waste it or just allow time to take it away from us. But today, Lord, we ask that our lives would count for thee. So Lord, today, thank you for your love. Thank you for giving to us thy full and free salvation so freely. And Lord, today we thank you and praise the name of Jesus before men. We ask this now in the blessed name of Jesus Christ, our Savior. Amen. So we want to, first of all, say thank you to Sue Durchy. She's provided the bulletins for us today in memory of Brother Durchy. And today is his birthday. And tomorrow is his birthday. Sorry. Yes. And so on July the 11th. And so anyway... You just let Sue know that you're praying for her, and just know it's been a difficult time in that matter, and so I can understand and relate. So thank you, Sue. Appreciate that so very much. Good to have visitors with us today, all the way from deep down south. have come up. We've visitors a little closer. Good to have you with us today. And so we welcome all of you, and just pray that God will bless in this hour that we have together. And again, my apologies for getting things off a little rough today, but sometimes that just happens. Anyway, thanks for being here. Let me remind you quickly of announcements. Our church council will be meeting tomorrow night, 6 p.m. On the 23rd will be our men's fellowship breakfast, and that's at the Moose at 9 a.m. And then on the 30th will be our chicken barbecue. So we're still asking if you would like to help us with tickets. We'd appreciate it. You can see Cheryl Chevalier right after service. Cheryl, wave. Okay. All right. Everybody sees. I see that hand. Okay. So anyway, if you have not got to purchase tickets or know someone who is interested, please let her know. So anyway, try to get that taken care of. And that chicken barbecue is always a good meal, and it's a half a chicken. And trust me, that's all you need. baked beans, coleslaw, rolling butter, dessert cookie. And this year it's drive-through service. Although I have said, if you want to stay and fellowship in the out in the shelter house, that is fine. Tickets are $10, and the proceeds will benefit a church choir. So be sure and make note of that, and remember afterwards to see her if you would. Also, want to remind you, our food pantry. Several people brought in food today, and we appreciate you helping us with that ongoing project and ministry. So we're praying that we can be a blessing and help to several. So Angie McGraw is in charge of that, and she's doing a good job with that. Also, I wanted to say thank you to Greg Gullett, who we've been talking several years now about getting this done. But anyway, our little shed out beside the shelter house has been re-sided. New plywood put on, and also new siding, and so it looks real nice and much stronger and safer than it was. So anyway, our thanks for getting that project done this past week. Seems like I'm missing something else, but if it is, I'm sorry. Okay, we'll just move on from there. Remind you of our tithes and offerings. Thank you again for your faithfulness in giving. Offering plate is, as you're going out, if you did not see it, on the right side of the door going out into the hall. And again, thank you for your faithfulness in supporting Fairpark Community Baptist Church. I appreciate it so very much. Let's stand. We're going to sing the doxology. Praise God, from whom all blessings flow. Brother Al. Praise God, from whom all blessings flow. Praise Him, all creatures here below. Praise Him above, ye heavenly hosts. Praise Father, Son, and Holy Ghost. Amen. Heavenly Father, we are so grateful that you give us an opportunity to share in the gospel of Jesus Christ. And thank you, Lord, for each who has brought an offering today. Bless them, we pray. And Lord, we ask for those who cannot give today that you would bless them and further their outreach for the cause of Christ. So we pray this in the blessed name of Jesus Christ, our Savior. Amen. Remain standing, and we are going to sing, if I turn to the right side of the page, Redeemed. Ruth Sala.
Child and forever I am redeemed. may be seated.
Thank you, Ruth Ella. Thank you for singing today. And a good crowd today. We're so glad you're here with us on this July Sunday. And good to have Brenda Hartley, who is going to be singing a special for us.
Thank you.
Thank you, Brenda. That's a good one. One of my favorites. Well, I'm glad you're here today. And again, my apologies to you for a little extracurricular activity going on up here on the up front. But anyway, we got things worked out and we're online and things are working, and I'm getting messages that people are watching. So that's a good thing. So we're glad they tuned in to our, I think it's probably by now the third broadcast we tried this morning, but it's working. So we're thankful for that. This morning, I want to share with you for just a little while. And by the way, let me thank all of you who supported us with Ed and Sue's viewing a week ago and then funeral. Anyway, thankful for all of your help and your support and your love that was shown to the family during that time. So again, thank you for your love, and still a great tragedy, but we know that there are no tragedies with God. He knows exactly what happens in our lives. And so I know they are home with the Lord today. And that brings me comfort and in my life. And I hope it produces that in yours as well. Today I want to preach to you about knowing oneself, about knowing who you are in relation to who God is in your life. You see, if we can learn to know who we are and what we can do, and I might add to that, and what we should not do, I think you're progressing along the path of being a Christian. And I think one of the first things that God wants us to know and to understand in our lives is our relationship with Him, and understanding if we accept who God has made us. Every one of us is unique. Every one of us is special. And every one of us is a little different. And I could say it that now. You didn't get that. But anyway, I meant a little funnily, in a funny way. We're all a little different. Each one of us has something that's just a little unique about us. I'm going to take my glasses off for a minute. You see this little red spot I have here? That's been a good source of conversation from people that don't know me over the years. What is that, Pastor? Well, I went and tried to have it taken care of here several months ago. And it's just some blood vessels that have risen to the top. And I had a doctor, and I won't tell you his name. But anyway, he told me I can get rid of that. Well, $500 later, he didn't get rid of it. It's still there. So anyway, so we are who we are. Isn't that true? I mean, you can't add an inch to your height. You can't change very much about your looks. You can maybe get your eyes pulled back a little bit and a few things like that. But you are who you are. And I think it's good to learn that in our lives, to accept that God has made us uniquely. We have to learn to accept ourselves. And then learn in our lives, as we trust in Jesus Christ as our Savior, that God gives us gifts, abilities to live for Him. Romans 12 is an amazing passage of Scripture. It touches on our lives and God's mercy that is presented. And He says, for ourselves as a living sacrifice. That we need to understand that God has made us, but we must reoffer ourselves to Him to be used of Him. And it says that is your reasonable service. So God wants for you and for me. And we understand that gift was so radical, so far-reaching, so important, so amazing, that He would send His Son to die for us. The world who spit upon Him and crucified Him and cursed Him, that same world, God sent His Son to die for us. And when we look at who we are and understand God's love reaches into the depths of who we are, then we get a glimpse of how much His love is so far-reaching. And so as God gives us a gift, and by the way, the word gift involves the word charisma or that giving of a special gift. There are some things that God gives us that really touches upon how He wants us to live and serve Him. There is the matter of prophecy or speaking. It's that ability to reveal what is known. It's taking, as I am doing today, the Word of God and sharing with you. It's touching our lives so that we might know and understand that we are part of Him. The word here of that's found in the Old King James of a prophet is really has to do with evangelism. It has to do with us giving out what has already been revealed in His Word of God. There is the gift also of ministry. And by the way, every last one of us today ought to be involved with that. The ministry of serving isn't just for a pastor. It isn't just for a few people. It's for all of us to serve. Just as the church so openly and lovingly and willingly prepared a meal for the family of the Shrakes, as we did some things that we wanted to show that we love them. That's service. That's giving. That's doing. There is that gift of ministry, of being a help in the active work of worship, of touching lives here in church, of giving of our finances, of reaching out to those who need Jesus Christ. There is that ministry that God says all of us should be involved with. There's a specific gift of teaching. And that's the ability to impart truth, to open it up and make it flower so others can say, oh, I see it now. I understand it. It makes sense to me. And that's that ability to teach. There's also the gift of exhortation. And exhortation simply means acting for God and loving Him and serving Him. But it goes to the action of what you are doing. There's the gift of giving. Now, God wants us all to be givers. Jesus spoke about the lady who had a mite, or which was a half of a penny, if you want to relate it in today's economy. It was a very small amount, but it was all she had, and she gave all she had to the Lord's work. It was that act of sharing and desiring to give what she had back to God. There is the gift of ruling, and that's the gift of administration or leading the house of God. And there is a gift of guidance. And guidance speaks specifically of being able to lead others to Christ, to lead others to understand who Jesus is. Now, when you take all of those things that are found here in this passage, and you find what God wants us to know, when he talks, Paul talks to us here, he says, I know through the grace given to me that every one of you has one thing we should not do, and that is to think too highly of ourselves or to build ourselves up. God doesn't want us to do that. He wants us to glory Him. And we need to look right past who we are to who He is so that we might do that well. In the book of Numbers chapter 8 and verse 19, there, the Lord was talking about the dealing of the temple and the work of the temple. And it involved more than just a high priest in the work of the old temple and actually going back to the tabernacle before the temple had yet been built. And it says, and I have given the Levites as a gift to Aaron and to his sons from among the children of Israel to do the service of the children of Israel in the tabernacle of the congregation, to make an atonement for the children of Israel, that there be no plague among the children of Israel when the children of Israel come nigh unto the sanctuary. God was relating to that time frame of people, His people, the children of Israel. That connecting to holiness is a very, very sacred thing, a very holy thing. And he wanted them to understand that sin separates and moves us away from the glory of God and the things of God. And to be into his presence, we have to understand there needs to be that connection made. That's why we come to church. We come into God's house to hear the Word of God, to learn the truth of the Word of God, to draw just a little bit closer than we were before. And when you think of that, I guess I start the message by saying this: what are you willing to do for God? What are you willing to do for God? Not your neighbor, or not your children, or not your mom and dad, but what are you willing to do for God? And see, the great matter here is there are two groups of people. There are doers, and there are spectators. There are those who sit on the sidelines and watch, but really don't participate or do. God wants us to be doers. I went out to Arizona with my son and family, and he had found a place I never even knew it existed, but it was where a large meteorite had fallen in Arizona and created the largest crater in the world. And everybody wants to see a hole in the ground, right? Yeah. So anyway, so we drove a couple hours, and got to this place. Then you had to pay to go in and see it, of course. You know, you couldn't just walk up to it. But anyway, it was so large that, as they were explaining it to us, 20 football fields would sit down inside it. And in the crater, the surrounding area, they said it would accommodate 2 million people if they were sitting there as spectators. So this was a large crater. The asteroid meteorite that fell was, they thought, 150 feet wide, and it exploded when it hit. And now there's only a piece about this big left of it. But it was amazing what it created. And I guess, might we question ourselves, are we doers? Do we do the things that need to be done? Or do we just listen? Do we just watch from the sidelines? And you see, commitment with God is a very important thing. And to be preoccupied with the Lord Jesus Christ, to understand who He is, if He is our Lord indeed, then you and I are His servants. I think that has to be primary in our hearts today. We have to be preoccupied with Christ. We have to think about Him. Our thoughts should go to who He is and what He does. There's a second matter involved with being a doer or being a spectator, and that's the occupation that you maintain. You do have an occupation. You're either a doer or you're a spectator. And it should be such that we are evangelistic in our outreach, that we're trying to tell others about Jesus Christ. We ought to be reaching out to others to reach up to God. And the third thing that I think is involved with this here is an inoculation. Now, I don't know, many of you have experienced the inoculation the last couple of years, right? Yeah. So anyway, there is an inoculation that is really good, okay? I'm finding out every time I get a new inoculation, I'm going to need another one. Have you heard that too? More and more and more. Well, there's one inoculation. If you get it, it will last you for your life, and that's the injection of the Holy Spirit. When the Holy Spirit takes up residence in your heart and life, when you surrender to Christ as your Savior, the Bible says your body becomes the temple of the Holy Ghost. And the Word should be built up in your life as a spiritual immunity to the things of the world. Not that you reject those in the world, but that you reject the things of the world. That's that inoculation, the work of the Holy Spirit. He tries to purify your life and make your life a little more like God's life. That's one of the things the Holy Spirit does. There's a fourth thing that should happen in your life, and that is the matter of dedication. And dedication means to sanctify, to be sanctified. And sanctification is an ongoing progress. It just continues. It's like some of you still get Saturday night baths. Is that right? I mean, you know, once a week at least you take a bath. Is that right? Yeah. I think a few do that. So, and I'm happy that you do. I really am. Well, sanctification is that ongoing process where you're renewed in the things of God. And when you come back to church, when you sit and listen to the Word of God, there arises in your heart a little more dedication. You become a little more involved. And the Holy Spirit takes that inoculation that He has done in your life, and you're sanctified, you're dedicated a little more today than you were yesterday. You see, God wants us to be dedicated people. He wants our lives to count for Him. I think one of the saddest things that happens in this world is we become so accustomed to what goes on around us that we lose sight of what is really important. It becomes we just get numb, I guess is the right word. And I heard in the George Patton, who was a famous general, he was amazed at how many people he had led, guided, and truly governed their lives for that period of war. And he said, out of all those, one person wrote back and said, "Thank you for taking good care of me. I'm thankful that you protected me as a soldier. You guided me, and the governance that you did in my life was right." There are a few points at which in human nature there is true gratitude. There is true thankfulness. I know we approach, as we come to the month of November, the matter called Thanksgiving, and certainly we're thankful for some things God did, but it ought to be more than once a year that we say thank you. Isn't that right? We ought to learn to say thank you. Parents, I think, have to constantly remind children when someone gives them a gift, remember to say thank you. That's a good lesson they need to learn. And the best rule, I think, is set by the Apostle Paul when he says this: in everything, give thanks. In everything, give thanks. He says in another passage in 1 Corinthians, thanks be unto God for His unspeakable gift. He was awed at what God had done for him. And when we learn to understand in that spirit of dedication that we're drawing into His presence, we ought to recognize several things. Number one, that we're dedicated to Jesus Christ. We're following Him. He is our leader. We need to be dedicated, by the way, to a book. And that's the Word of God. There's a lot of self-help books. There's a lot of good books out there. There's a lot of books written about the book. But folks, there is nothing like the Bible. That's our book. And that's our guide. And that's the governance of our life, is following the Word of God. By the way, we ought to be dedicated to an organization. That's God's church. He talks about the consecration of the church and the connection of the church, and that we are here today to live and honor Christ in the church. And that's how Christ wants it to be. And I think that says two things. That, first of all, fellow Christians need to be involved. It's not just a person's responsibility or a pastor's responsibility. It's all of our responsibility to be dedicated to see that the church goes on, that it grows, that it's increased, not for the sake of numbers, but for the sake of souls that need Jesus Christ as Lord and Savior. And I think we need to understand the unsaved have to be involved. We have to win them in. It's, and I'm sure you understand this today, it's more so now than ever before, a world that does not believe in who Jesus is. A world who doesn't believe that we need religion. A world that thinks there is no need for a God. That things are okay. Well, they're not okay. And I think you'd agree with me, this world is in a mess, amen? It's in a mess. And unless they trust in Jesus Christ as Savior, that will not change. And then I wanted to share with you this final point, and I'll be done. The responsibility that needs to happen is so important, and we need to be so understanding of this. I want to read for you out of 1 Corinthians, and I'm going to look this up here. But I want to share with you just how important this verse is in chapter 10. And you're welcome to turn there if you have your Bibles available to you there. 1 Corinthians chapter 10. And verse number 31. It says, whether, therefore, if you eat or drink or whatever you do. So we're talking about the basics of nature, just the getting up in the morning and the living of life. It says, whether you eat or drink or whatever you do, do all to the glory of God. That's how God wants us to live our lives. That's our responsibility. That's our life's mission, to live in an honoring way for God. And He wants us to dedicate ourselves to the work that is before us. It hasn't stopped. It isn't finished. It isn't done. Until God calls every one of us home, the work goes on. We need to dedicate ourselves. We need to look at the things that can be accomplished. We need to look at those around us who need Jesus Christ as Savior. It ought to be a work today. This needs to be a work that wins sinners. It needs to be a work that sees believers mature in the things of God. It ought to be a work that shows others how to love Jesus. And finally, it ought to be a work with a message of overthrowing who Satan is. I know Herbert Hoover wasn't one of the more popular presidents, but he had something to say that I thought was very valuable. And I think everyone who has been placed in our charge has something to say that's important. And Hoover, President Hoover said this. He said, the new order, the new freedom. Now, these are words spoken back in 1930, by the way. The new order, the new freedom, the new day, the new outlook, the new epoch, the new economy, the new deal, the new religion, the new liberalism, the new war, the new policy. He said, we've overworked the word new in trying to get out of misery. And he says, he was speaking in his time, from the past 37 years of hot and cold wars, with intervals of hot and cold peace. He said, the practical thing, if we want to make the world over, is to try out the word old for a moment. Some old things made this country. Some old things are slipping. And if they slip too far, the light will go out in America. Old virtues, religious faith, whole truth, integrity, honor in public office, economy in government, individual liberty, willingness to sacrifice. And he went on to say, we have a cancerous growth of intellectual dishonesty in public life, mostly beyond law. He said, our great danger is suicide by compliance with evil. Boy, that sounds a lot like today, doesn't it? And what I'm saying is this. In this world, as it evolves and as it constantly tries to become new and more impressive, and again, because of the dullness of humanity, they latch onto that and think, this is a better thing. But folks, there is nothing better than Jesus Christ. There is nothing that will get you to heaven but Jesus Christ. There is no one who will give you an eternity with God except Jesus Christ. And oh, today, I hope you have trusted in Him as Lord and Savior. And if you've never made that decision in your heart and your life, I hope you'll give your heart to Him today. Doesn't matter whether we're old or whether we're young. Doesn't matter what we look like. God loves us. And together He can use us. And I pray our lives will count for Him. I want us to stand today. We're going to sing Jesus is Calling. And we're going to sing just the first and second verse of Jesus is Calling, Brother Al. And as we do this, I want you to think in your life, have I given my life? I want you to think, have you lately made sure that you're living for Jesus, that you're counting for Him? And the opportunity today is for you to do that very thing. I'll be waiting up here. If you'd like to come, I'll pray with you. If you like to meet Jesus, I can show him to you today. And you can walk away knowing he is your Lord. He is your Savior. Ruth Ella? Thank you for listening to the Word of God today. And I pray we know that we have been called, that we are His, and that we are useful in His service. Don't ever feel like you're not useful. You always are useful. And God wants you to count for Him before one day soon He comes back for us. My thanks to Jeff Ansbaugh for helping us rope this Facebook page and getting it under control there. I appreciate that today, Jeff. And thanks to all of you for all you've done. Thanks, Brenda, for singing today, and Brother Al for playing, and Ruth for leading, and for each one that does so very much. For Doug that prints the bulletin for us, and I know he wasn't feeling quite up to snuff, and he's here today, and I appreciate him and Cheryl being here today. I really do. Appreciate each one of you and love you in the Lord. Let's go away encouraged in who God is and what He has done for us, and just love Him a little more as we leave this place today. I'm going to ask Brother David Lippert, if you would please, sir, dismiss us in a word of prayer.
Dear Lord, help us to